السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. My beloved brothers and sisters, the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something that we should all fear. And the truth is, every time a calamity strikes, every time something happens, it's only natural for us to ask ourselves, is this the punishment of Allah? You see, dark clouds. Allah has sent dark clouds in the past to nations to destroy them. So it is only a good question to ask yourself, are these dark clouds coming to me as a punishment, or are they coming to us as a rahmah and a mercy of Allah, or is it actually going to come with destruction, but not a punishment, a test? So these are three things we need to understand. How do we look at this? Now, the only answer can be from revelation. I cannot come up with an answer from my pocket, nor can you. So I have to turn the pages of the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and I have to look at what Allah says about the punishment and the mercy of Allah, because those are two that are qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is something Allah has promised. So let's take a look at Surah Al-A'raf, verse number 156, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about adab. Allah says,
قَالَ عَذَابِي أُصِيبُ بِهِ مَنْ أَشَاءُ.
He says, it is my punishment and I will inflict it on whomsoever I wish. That verse brings about a lot of fear, because Allah says, my punishment, I will inflict it on whomsoever I wish. But now we have something else that Allah says to us, that I will never punish a person unless he or she deserves the punishment. Subhanallah. So I need to know, Allah's not going to punish me unless I deserve the punishment. And if I deserve the punishment, Allah says, still I may forgive you and I may just wipe out your sins by my mercy, even though you had deserved to be punished. Subhanallah. So let's understand, Allah's not going to punish an innocent person. Do you know why? He is just. If you want to be saved from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you need to seek the forgiveness of Allah every day. You need to be in the company of good people. Where do we get this from? Again, the Quran. Allah speaks about the kuffar of Quraysh. They were harassing the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were doing so much against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it's so simple to understand that if this is the most loved of creation unto Allah, and you're troubling him, you're harassing him, Allah can wipe you out, right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about something amazing. Allah says,
وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَأَنْتَ فِيهِمْ وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ مُعَذِّبَهُمْ وَهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ.
Allah will not punish them for as long as you are in their midst. Notice how I said you must have good company. It will bring about the mercy of Allah. Your friends must be better than you. Your friends must have language with no F's and B's, subhanallah. Your friends must speak the truth. They must be upright individuals. They must remind you of Allah. You'll never regret that. The minute your circle is dirty, you may deserve the punishment of Allah. When your circle is clean, wallahi, my beloved brothers and sisters, sometimes Allah does not punish us because of one man in our community whom he loves. Evidence of it is this verse. This verse, Allah says, you know what? How can we punish them when you are there? You are right in their midst. Allahu Akbar. May Allah grant us the love of one another. You never know who is the wali of Allah. You never know who is the friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have that. Allah says, while you are in their midst, we're not going to punish them. So punishment cannot come in that condition. Secondly, we will never punish them while they are seeking the forgiveness of ours, while they are seeking the forgiveness of Allah. That means if I want to divert or avert punishment that is coming in my direction, first thing I need to do, seek the forgiveness of Allah. The problem with man is man says people are bad, that's why Allah is punishing them, but he doesn't look at himself being bad. You see? We point fingers at others. That man is like this. This woman is like that. That one is committing that. This one is committing. What about you and I?
إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ.
Allah won't change the condition of a community or a nation until and unless every individual changes his own condition. May Allah help us change our conditions. So this is as far as I'm going to go, speaking about the punishment of Allah. But let's continue with the verses, because when we talk of the mercy of Allah, we will automatically understand how to protect ourselves from the punishment. So Allah says in the same verse, Allah says, after speaking about the punishment and saying, I will inflict with it whoever I wish. And I explain to you who that is. Then Allah says,
وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ.
As for my mercy, it has encompassed everything. My brothers and sisters, whatever you and I have is because of the mercy of Allah. We don't deserve it. We don't deserve it. If I were to tell you, do you know that your heart beats 136,000 times a day? If you were to pay 1 rand for every heartbeat, and I'm sure we would, I mean, if we had to, people do, pay an arm and a leg when the heart goes wrong. When your heartbeat is not right, you'll go to every cardiologist on earth in order to find out what's going on. And that's it. You'll pay thousands. You'll want to borrow or whatever else, because your heartbeat has gone wrong. Did you ever praise the one who gave you 136,000 heartbeats on average on a daily basis? Imagine 136,000 rands a day. You can't do that. Even if he gave you 50% discount, even if he told you 90% discount, you and I cannot afford that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. So my beloved brothers and sisters, Allah says, وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ. The whole world, the entire creation is standing upon the mercy of Allah. It is because of the mercy of Allah. It is reported that Israfil will blow the trumpet declaring the end of the entire creation and world, meaning this particular world, before it we are resurrected again into what Allah wills, when Allah is angry with the people on earth. So Israfil will blow the trumpet, ending this worldly life that we know completely, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect us later. But when will that happen? When Allah is angry with us. So whatever we are having right now is because of the mercy of Allah. That's why when someone says, how are you, my brother? What's the good answer? Alhamdulillah, even though you're suffering. People say, everything okay? It's not okay, but what's the answer? Alhamdulillah, right or wrong? What's another answer? Shukr. What's shukr? It means gratitude, thanks to Allah. People say, how's business? You're suffering a loss. But you say, shukr. What does that mean? I'm thanking Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us his shukr, meaning the ability to be thankful and show gratitude. So this is something amazing that Allah is telling us, rahmati, my mercy encompasses everything. But who will I write it for? Who deserves it?
فَسَأَكْتُبُهَا لِلَّذِينَ يَتَّقُونَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِآيَاتِنَا يُؤْمِنُونَ.
I will write it for those. And when Allah says, I will write it, He has written it. He says, I will write it for those. لِلَّذِينَ يَتَّقُونَ. Those who have taqwa. I'm going to translate that just now. وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ. Those who give charities to the poor. And zakah also means to develop yourself. Tazkiyah. It means to develop yourself, your character, your conduct, and your qualities. The heart needs to be cleansed when it comes to how it interacts with the rest of creation. So taqwa, zakat, and those who believe firmly in our signs. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِآيَاتِنَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Those who believe in our signs, they have taqwa, and they give zakat. Those are the ones whom we will write our mercy for. My brothers and sisters, these things depict two major aspects of our relationships. Taqwa is to develop the correct relationship with Allah, to have enough love of Allah that would keep you away from that which is bad and harmful to you, as well as displeasing to Allah. I love Allah so much, I don't want to displease Him. So it is a fear that is born out of love. That's something people don't explain usually. When someone says, fear Allah, I mean, I'm not scared to the degree that I'm petrified of meeting Him. No, I must love Him to the degree that I don't want to disobey Him because I fear His displeasure and His anger. It's true, I fear His punishment as well out of love. Imagine when you love someone, and I always give this example, a spouse. You just newly got married and you really love your spouse. Notice I said newly married because later on only Allah knows what happens. May Allah bless us all and grant us all the happiest of marriages. Ameen. So, you know, when you're newly married and you don't want to say anything that will actually hurt your spouse, not because you fear them, but because you fear hurting them. You fear upsetting them out of love. It's love. So it's the love of Allah. The love of Allah is everything. That love of Allah, the taqwa is born out of love of Allah. And that includes fear. Because you actually fear the displeasure of Allah, the wrath of Allah, the anger of Allah, the punishment of Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us quite clearly. He is saying something amazing. He says, taqwa alladhina yattaquna. On one hand, they develop the correct relationship with Allah. And on the other hand, yu'tuna zakah. They develop the correct relationship with the human beings around them. The poor, the downtrodden, the people who don't have as much as you, the people around you, how do you treat them? Do you give them? And notice a charity in Islam, as much as zakah is monetary and material, without a doubt. But charity in Islam goes beyond material giving. Tabassumuka fi wajhi akhika sadaqa. The hadith says your smile at the face of your fellow brother is a charity. Subhanallah, your expression on your face, come in, have hashash, bashash, you're happy, you're smiling, salamu alaykum, how are you my brother, etc., etc., and you're looking so good, mashallah, and that is actually a charity. It is a huge charity. Sometimes it is priceless. Sometimes people don't need your money. The people in your masjid, for example, in your locality, in your areas, they may not need your money. They just need you to be a genuine, sincere person who cares for them as much as they care for themselves. Today, westernization is taking over. And one of the weaknesses is people are becoming selfish. It's all about me, myself, and I. I must grow, I must have the money, I must have the business, I must have the goodness, and everybody else, nothing. I don't care and I'm not bothered. But if I'm doing well, I'm okay. I'm sitting in my house, me and my kids are doing well and that's it. No, a true mu'min, alladhina yu'tuna zakata. Did you look for the poor? Did you find them? Did you reach out to them? Did you give them with respect and dignity? That's what it is. Today we have organizations, Al-Imdad, Abdullah Aid, whoever else it may be across the globe, genuine people who are doing our work for us. So we are lucky. By right, we were supposed to look out for the poor, search for them, hunt them, respect them, honor them, give them with dignity, because my pillar of Islam is being fulfilled by your presence in our community and society. If you were not here, how would I have fulfilled zakat even if I have the millions? And there is a sign of Qiyamah that tells us there will come a time when nobody will be accepting zakat because everybody is going to be loaded. The youngsters say, hey, I can't wait for that time. Hey, I need the money, man. Subhanallah. But you don't realize a door will be closed. MashaAllah, may Allah make this rain that we're having right now the rain of mercy. Beautiful rain, MashaAllah. May Allah make it the rain of mercy and not the rain of adab. So as I'm saying, zakah, what is that all about? Why does Allah say, my rahmah will descend on those who have a good relationship with me. Your taqwa will lead you to your proper dress code. Your taqwa will lead you to leaving things that are doubtful. Something you're doubting, quit it. People ask me, you know, am I allowed to do this, for example? And I say, subhanallah, you know, they will ask you, I'm just giving you an example. They'll ask you, you know, there is a nail polish that I came across and they've sworn that it's permeable. And so can I use this nail polish? And I'll tell them, you know what? If you use it and you believe that it's permeable because they told you that, and half the world is telling you it's not, if you have taqwa, you're going to say, listen, I'm not going to compromise my relationship with Allah because of 1 inch of paint. I'll use something else. I'll use henna. That's the best answer. I don't want to get into the debate as to whether it's permeable or not. I have enough taqwa, or I should be having enough taqwa. May Allah strengthen us to say, you know what, my relationship with Allah is more important. Leave it. You find a place, people are saying halal, people are saying haram. Eat veggies that day. You know why? Because my relationship with Allah is far greater than a burger. It's far greater than the chips. But sometimes people are prepared to compromise that relationship. May Allah strengthen us. My beloved brothers and sisters, that is taqwa. Taqwa is when you can take your time in salah. Taqwa is when you can enjoy what ibadah you are fulfilling for the sake of Allah. When you do that, Allah says, my rahmah will be written for you. And automatically you need a relationship with who? With the other people. Allah created them, your neighbors, the people who you might not have liked. It's easy to be good to someone you like. What about those who don't really get along with you? Are you good to them? Are you genuine to them? Are you okay? Will you reach out to them? Will you go out and look for them and be kind to the poor and so on? That is called yu'tuna zakah. You know what? Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِآيَاتِنَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Those who believe in our signs. And you know who are those?
الَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ الرَّسُولَ النَّبِيَّ الْأُمِّي الَّذِي يَجِدُونَهُ مَكْتُوبًا عِنْدَهُمْ فِي التَّوْرَاةِ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَاهُمْ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ.
Amazing verse. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they are the ones who follow the messenger who was unlettered. Unlettered, by the way, does not refer to uneducated, astaghfirullah. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the most highly educated. He was educated by Allah. He was given the gift. He knew more than everyone put together. So Allah didn't want him to read and write simply because he didn't want them to say that he read from elsewhere and he wrote something. And that's quite clear in the Quran. Allah says, إِذَا لَرْتَابَ الْمُبْطِلُونَ. Had he been able to read or write, then some people might have come to create doubts. But Allah says, you know what? He was the most highly educated. To this day, we have teachings that will bowl mid-wicket, will bowl out any educated person. Look at the virus that has taken over by storm. Tell me the role of the black seed. Tell me the role of the oil, the black seed oil, and what it played and continues to play, and where did it come from? Subhanallah. What did they find its contents? Did they not find the contents of it, including some chloroquine? Subhanallah. Who taught us? When we say unlettered, we are never ever referring to something derogatory or something blasphemous. May Allah grant us ease. Those who want to achieve the rahmah of Allah, they will follow the Nabi. They will follow his path. They will follow his way. And why? Because whatever he brought was good. Whatever he told us not to do was bad. And he enjoined that which was good, and he told us to enjoin what is good. He discouraged and prohibited evil, and he told us to prohibit evil. If you follow his path, you will definitely be successful. Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. Those are the ones who are successful. So I end on this note, and I just want to recap and remind myself and yourselves to say, if we would like to be protected from the punishment of Allah, we need definitely, if we want to be protected from the punishment of Allah, we need to seek the forgiveness of Allah. May Allah forgive us. If we want the mercy of Allah, we must develop a relationship with Allah, be kind to fellow human beings, and follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us every success. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد.